the inequality between disabled men and disabled women in terms of having less chance of education, more chance of having violence, less chance of having health care. There's so many things where disabled women, you know, globally are doubly discriminated.
Great point. Yeah.
So let's get down to the heart of Mobility International USA. So what inspired you to co-found MyUSA? Tell us a little bit about your early days, who your other founder was.
Yeah, sure. So I was a undergraduate actually at the University of California at Berkeley, and I saw an ad in the newspaper saying be an ambassador of goodwill, all expenses paid. And I thought, oh my gosh, that sounds so fabulous. And I applied, and it was for a Rotary scholarship, and I get to pick if I got accepted where I want. And I was probably one of the first wheelchair users to apply for that type of program, and I got accepted, and I spent a year at the University of Queensland in Brisbane, Australia, and I had the most amazing year. I did all sorts of wild things and had a just an unbelievable, fabulous time, like many non-disabled people who take a year abroad. But it really struck me that there were no other people with disabilities who were participating in international exchange like non-disabled people do. So after I finished my year in Australia, I traveled through Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand with another friend of mine. I did some wild things like hitchhiking my wheelchair through New Zealand with a friend who actually also was in a wheelchair. And then I came back and I decided to finish my master's degree at the University of Oregon in Eugene, Oregon. And Barbara Williams, I met her, and she was also a graduate student. And we just decided to co-found this organization called Mobility International with the idea of increasing the number of people with disabilities, all types of disabilities, and all types of international exchange. And from that, which was now, I think, like, oh my gosh, maybe 37 years ago, we have not only had many disabled people join existing international exchange programs, study abroad, but we've also run our own leadership programs. We're known for our disabled women's leadership programs. We're doing lots of different types of work that you can see on our website. But it really, you know, it really started just while I was a student. So I guess my message is, you know, I really want to encourage maybe people who are listening to have ideas, perhaps their students or whoever, to, you know, to surround yourself by people who maybe think that your idea is a good idea, and when possible, to either get a job in either international exchange. We also work in international development, or sometime for many disabled people, it's starting their own organization.
Wow, that's great to hear for what's coming up next. So next, we're going to move on to women with disabilities. Intrinsic to your work is a focus on the issue of women with disabilities. So why have you focused a major part of your work specifically on women with disabilities?
Well, obviously, one is that, you know, growing up as a woman with a disability, it's obviously near and dear to my heart. And just the inequality between disabled men and disabled women in terms of having less chance of education, more chance of having violence, less chance of having health care. There's so many things where disabled women, you know, globally are doubly discriminated against. But as we always like to say, yes, that's all true. But I also think for being a disabled woman also gives women two things to be proud of. One is to be a woman and to feel proud of who they are, and also to be a woman with disability, which I see as being part of this amazing family of disabled women. and to turn that into a positive aspect of your identity. And so, you know, our work has been both with disabled men and women, but we're very much known for our disabled women's program. And one of our trademark slogans is loud, proud, and passionate. And that's, you know, some of the things that we're trying to give to disabled women so they can go back and make the changes for other disabled women in their countries and the communities, because our WILD program is definitely a train the trainer model. Right now it is for people from outside the U.S., mostly the global south, but I think disabled women is just a powerful force. I also realize now that many people maybe who are listening don't necessarily identify as either male or female. And so I think we also really need to look at gender issues, realizing that many people are gender fluid or nonconforming as well.
I know you've traveled to some pretty accessible cities in the last few months, DC, Barcelona. What's been the most wheelchair accessible city you've been to around the world?
You know, I never know. I'm really terrible on what is the most. I have to say that in, for instance, Barcelona, the buses, at least the ones I was taking, I found to be pretty accessible. A lot of times in the Scandinavian countries, the public transportation seems to be accessible. But there's also, they have a lot of frustrating things too, where you expect it to be accessible and it's not, and then you're really surprised. So, yeah, I always sort of shy a little bit away from, I don't know if there's a place that has the most accessible.
So for me, I feel like DC is definitely one of the most wheelchair accessible cities I've ever lived in, with, you know, right, all the buses being wheelchair accessible, yeah, and all the metro stations having an elevator.
Right. I guess in the U.S., definitely Washington, D.C., San Francisco, the BART is accessible across all places. Sometimes the elevator breaks down. You have to deal with that. The buses are accessible. And actually, here in good old Eugene, Oregon, where our office is based, I do think it is one of the most accessible places. All our buses were accessible before the Americans with Disabilities Act. We have, you can rent an adaptive bicycle, you can go skiing, you can go river rafting, you can do lots of things. So I find, you know, people don't know much about Eugene, Oregon, but it's definitely up there in very accessible cities. And then I think, too, the power of disabled people trying to do the best that they can and make changes in the country is happening all over the world. And we have a website called globaldisabilityrightsnow.org, which talks about disabled people making changes legally in places like Armenia, Mexico, Peru, Guatemala, Kenya, Armenia. So again, I think the ADA has really helped us here in the United States, but there's also many disabled people around the world who are also fighting equally hard to get stronger laws in their countries.